Welcome to this third lecture on heat transfer by convection. In this lecture, we discuss boundary layer equations for the case of natural convection. The learning goals are understanding the boundary layer profile, both for temperature as well as velocity, for the case of a flat plate with natural free convection. And to the right side, you see a profile, this profile drawn for the case of a vertical flat plate. There is a dimensionless number that governs the behavior, and this dimensionless number is the Grassof number, and we explain you the derivation and the meaning of this number. Finally, I would like you to understand and have knowledge of the differences between the boundary layer profiles for forced and free convection. Note that both natural and free convection are terms that are used intermittently in the literature and in lectures, and they both mean the same. We go back to classification of convection according to the flow regime, and we distinguish different regimes. First of all, we distinguish external versus internal flows, that is the flow around an object versus the flow inside an object. And then we distinguish forced convection, where the flow is driven by external means, and free convection, where the flow is driven by the density differences due to the differences in temperature. Free convection is the case that we consider in this lecture. There are two variations. The one is the external free convection, and the second one is the internal free convection. Here's an example of external free convection. You see a picture of a lady, and around the lady you see air, and you see different shadows, and this is a shadow graph or a Schlieren picture. And what happens here is that the temperature in the air is different at different locations. And because light is refracted differently depending on the temperature, we see that we'll have shadows created on the wall. These shadows will, of course, move when the air moves. And this then shows us the flow around the person, or in fact, the temperature around the person. And in the movie, you can beautifully see the effect of natural convection. That is, the temperature of the person is higher than the environment, and you see that the density near the person is smaller than far away, and this smaller density air is driven upwards, it starts to flow upwards, and then you see a flow pattern develop. You can also beautifully see that the temperature of the air coming from the nose by breathing is also different and also affects the flow. Let's look at this free convection case in more detail, in particular at the development of the boundary layer. The generic case that we study for free convection is usually a vertical plate, and this plate is indicated in red here, a vertical plate that is hotter than the environmental air. And the air far away has a lower temperature, which is indicated by the fact that the boundary layer thickness here is drawn in blue. At the plate, we have a higher temperature, far away, we have a lower temperature, and in this boundary layer, the temperature decreases from the plate temperature to the boundary temperature. Because the wall is hot, the density near the wall is lower than far away, and this creates a flow upward along the plate. This is what we see in the velocity profile. Near the wall, we have the zero slip condition, no velocity. Far away, we don't have a flow, so in between we have a transition from an increasing velocity to a lower velocity. And this is the same at all locations in the boundary. And we thus have an upward flow for the case of a hot plate in a cold air. If we have a cooling through the wall, that means that the air around it is hotter than the plate, then the situation is reversed. There we will have a flow in the downward direction, and we again have a lower temperature, and then we have a higher temperature around it. So for natural convection, in a case of a cool wall, we have a downward flow. Let's review our conservation equations for the case of a two-dimensional problem, steady state and an incompressible fluid. First, we have the continuity equation. Then for each direction we have the momentum equation, and third we have the energy equation. The x direction is the direction along the plate, the y direction is the direction perpendicular to the plate. In the momentum equation we have the diffusive effect of momentum represented by the viscosity. In the energy equation, we have the diffusive effect of temperature represented by the ratio of viscosity and Prandtl number. In this case, where the flow is driven by density differences, buoyancy, gravity, we have to add the effect of gravity to the momentum equation in the x direction. In the x direction, we also know what the pressure gradient is. This is equal to minus rho infinity times g. And we can combine that in the term on the right in the green box. We can write the gravity term then as the g divided by rho times rho infinity minus rho. Now we consider again the case of a boundary layer, where we assume that the boundary layer thickness is much smaller than the length of the plate. The velocity along the plate is much larger than the velocity perpendicular to the plate, which means that the gradients in the x direction along the plate are much smaller than the gradients in the y direction. If we invoke this assumption, we can cancel terms in our equations. The first term that we can cancel is the second derivative of u with respect to x. In the y momentum equation, because the v is small, we can cancel the advective terms. We can cancel the diffusive terms. And that then leads to, and in the energy equation, we can cancel the derivative, second derivative of temperature with respect to the x direction. The y-momentum equation leads to the conclusion that the dpdy, the pressure variation across the boundary layer, is going to be small, which in fact means that we can cancel this entire equation. Now we have to model the behavior of this gravity term. For that, we introduce the volumetric expansion coefficient of the gas or the fluid. And this is defined as the change of volume with respect to temperature at constant pressure, and then the relative change, so we have 1 over V, dV dt at constant pressure, which we can write as minus 1 over rho, the rho dt at constant pressure, and this can be written as the ratio of rho infinity minus rho, the density difference, divided by rho times t minus t infinity. So we see that this density difference, the volumetric expansion coefficient, depends on the temperature. If we substitute that in our equation, the term that represents the driving force of natural convection is beta times g times t minus t infinity. These are the three equations that we have to solve to obtain the boundary layer for the velocity and for the temperature in the case of a free convection along a flat plate. And mind you that here we consider the case of a laminar flow. A few words more about this coefficient of volumetric expansion. It is again defined here. If we look at the ideal gas, then the law for the ideal gas, the equation of state, is the P times V is N times R times T, where N is the amount of substance, R is the universal gas constant. And if we combine this, then we can see that the ratio V over T is NR over P, and that is a constant. From this, it follows that the derivative of V with respect to T at constant pressure is going to be V over T. And from that, it immediately follows that beta, the volumetric expansion coefficient, is, for an ideal gas, is beta is 1 over T. Usually in problems, of course, we have temperature that varies. There's a temperature at the wall and a temperature at the end of the boundary layer. And to represent this correctly, we take the mean temperature, which is the average of the wall temperature and the temperature at infinity. So 1 over T then equals 2 divided by T wall plus 2 infinity. To see which parameters are now really important in our equation, we can look at dimensionless equations. And we can introduce scaling, we can introduce x star is x over a length scale, y star is y over a length scale, the u star, the dimensionless velocity, is u over u infinity, the v star is v over u infinity, and the theta, the dimensionless temperature, where we use the temperature difference, is t minus t infinity over t wall minus t infinity. If we substitute these quantities in our equations, we have the continuity equation as written here, the u star dx star plus dv star dy star equals zero. The momentum equation has to the left the advective terms u star du star dx star plus v star du star dy star. And on the right hand side, we now get dimensionless numbers in our equation. The first dimensionless number is the Reynolds number. And the second dimensionless number is the one that multiplies the term related to gravity, which is beta gl t wall minus t infinity divided by u infinity squared. In the energy equation, we have in the same case, the same as we had before for forced convection, we have 1 over the Reynolds times Prandtl number, which is the Picklin number. Let's look again at the term here in the green box. We can write this quantity as the product of beta g rho squared tw minus t infinity over eta squared l to the power 3 times eta rho u infinity l squared. And we can write it as a dimensionless number Grashof times 1 over Reynolds squared. So here we see a new dimensionless number appear, that is the Grashof number. Grashof number is the beta, the volumetric expansion coefficient, gravity, density squared, temperature difference, length scale to the power 3, divided by viscosity squared. And the Grashof number now represents the ratio of the buoyancy forces, that is these forces, to the viscous forces, that is this force. If we want to estimate the size of this number, if we look at air, then the viscosity of air is usually something like 10 to the power minus 5, and that means that the Grashof number is often a very large number. These equations can be solved and the results can be represented in dimensionless numbers. And here you can see some of these graphs. The first to the left indicates the velocity profile and the one to the right the temperature profile. The velocity profile is here presented as a function of a dimensionless coordinate in the y direction. And this dimensionless coordinate contains the Grashof number. And we look at the velocity, the dimensionless velocity, which also contains the Grashof number. And we see that if we go from 0 to a large value of xi, we increase the velocity and then it decreases again. The result, of course, depends on the Prandtl number. If the Prandtl number is large, then we have low velocity. If the Prandtl number is small, we have higher velocities and we have a thicker boundary layer. Higher dimensionless velocities, that is. If we look at the temperature profile, then here we see that depending on the Prandtl number, when the Prandtl number is large, we have a thin boundary layer, and when the Prandtl number is small, we have a thicker boundary layer. And of course, here for the temperature heat transfer by convection, the gradient of the temperature profile at the wall is important. So what we want to know is how the Nusselt number, the dimensionless heat transfer coefficient, behaves. And we can write this as the temperature gradient at the wall times lambda divided by, multiplying x divided by lambda, which we can write as the Grashof number divided by 4 to the power 1 over 4 times the dimensionless derivative of the temperature profile at the wall. And this Nusselt number then obviously depends on the Grashof number and on the Prandtl number. Now let's compare the results that we have for free convection, the laminar case, to forced convection. For the forced convection, we had a Nusselt number, dimensionless heat transfer coefficient, that depended on the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number. Now we have a Nusselt number that depends on the Grashof number and the Prandtl number. For the forced convection and a flat plate, we found Nusselt is 0.332 times Reynolds x to the power half Prandtl to the power 1 over 3. And when we averaged it over the entire plate, we found 0.664 Reynolds to the power half Prandtl to the power 1 over 3. Where here the Reynolds number is the local Reynolds number, and here the Reynolds number is defined with the length scale, the length of the plate. For free convection, the expressions are more complex. Here we see Nusselt as a function of the Grashof number at x and the Prandtl number. And when we average over the plate, we have to integrate this expression, and then we find an expression like here, 0.677 Prandtl divided by 0.952 plus Prandtl to the power 1 over 4 times the product of Grashof and Prandtl to the power 1 over 4. So we see that for the forced versus free convection, we have correlations for the Nusselt number, for the case of forced convection of, as a function of Reynolds and Prandtl, for the case of free convection as a function of Grashof and Prandtl. Now let's look at some comprehension questions. The first question is obviously, what is the driving potential of natural convection? And this is the density differences caused by changes in the temperature. The second question is, why are buoyancy forces negligible in forced convection? That is because the velocities are usually much smaller and the Reynolds number thus is small. This concludes lecture number 3. Thank you for your attention.